Hello, good morning. I hope that everybody is well and ready to discuss about our new topic. Please let me know if you are able to properly hear and see the screen. Okay, thank you, Adrian. So today we will discuss about reactive programming and also how the Kotlin coroutines are providing us an alternative on organizing our asynchronous code and how we can use also other operators and transformers to fill the gaps properly. When dealing with execution threads. So first we will discuss about reactive. Before coroutines, the RX packages were the ones that were recommended to be used. And we should question ourselves, why should we use such a framework? Why should we deal with asynchronous streams and why the need for React, let's say RX, reactive programming. And here we have a quote that is saying, unless we can model everything synchronous, we will not be able to properly handle. So as long as we have a single asynchronous source, it will break us our imperative model. And we are starting to discuss why we should use RX using a model here. So let's imagine that we have a user manager or a DAO, if you like. So an object that will encapsulate our logic to deal with users. And right now we have a method to retrieve the current user. And we would like to have some helper methods like setting a name, setting an age for a user, let's say. And we will use something like this. Let's say from a manager, we will retrieve the current user. And the purpose of this demo is to log the user information. And after we are performing some changes, like setting a name, to log again the user information. And as we know, the information from the mobile app should be sent to a repository when we are dealing with user information. So this interface that we are defining with getters and setters related to the user should end up, the information should end in the repository. And when we are dealing with a remote repository, either a database or a true network implementation, we are dealing with async operations. That's because, like we discussed on DB lecture, everything that is performed on the UI thread, so on the thread that is responsive with the painting of the user interface, so we should pay attention and we should implement only logic and use methods that may not, let's say, delay the user interaction, may not create jank, as they name it. So they may not create lag for the user. By lag here, we are specifying the feeling that the user will have when interacting, let's say, with a drop-down, with a button, with a list. So if the UI will not respond for the user interactions, it means that the thread behind the scenes is waiting for something, is performing some calculation that is delaying the process of painting the response. And because of that, most of the user interface implementations will guide us whenever we need to perform a DB call or a network operation to use an asynchronous call, to run that code on a background thread. And as we already know, we are not allowed to perform network calls on the main thread and also DB operations on the main thread, the UI thread. So naturally, we would like to have those operations that are, let's say, performing the marshaling of the data to a server or to a DB to be asynchronous. Okay, and by doing that, some synchronization issues will arrive. So if we are imagining here, let's say, changing the name and then performing the logout, here we may have a potential issue. What happens if that change of the name is not happening on time before we are logging the operation? So if the set name is asynchronous, it may take a couple of seconds and we will log the stale information related to the user. So the call with our log may be delayed and present old data. And because of this, a lot of implementations were proposed. One of them is to use callbacks. And here the idea is that whenever we will perform a name change operation or an age change operation, we will get a callback when the server or the DB engine will notify us when the operation was either successfully or unsuccessfully performed. And in that callback, we have the chance to react, and we will be able to log properly the fresh information related to the user. And here, by using our approach, let's say that code will look something like this. We are performing our GET calls with sending the data to a server. Let's say that server may register. So here we may imagine that when we are pushing the user information, let's say, or retrieving the user information, we are not retrieving it directly from our server implementation or from the server that we contacted. Behind the scenes, we may have I don't know, registering services or other third-party servers that thanks for that, Razvan. So behind the scenes, we may have multiple servers that are retrieving our user information. And here we can imagine that we have some servers that will gather that information. And if one of those are failing, then we are not properly able to present the results. So because of that, we may need to react, let's say, to the server response. And another model was implemented using listeners. And here we have, maybe if you work with JavaScript, you already know that with frameworks like React, let's say, there we have this model where we have a success or a failure callback that will allow us to properly handle the response call. And that's a variation that can be used, but it's adding a lot of boilerplate code. And here we can see how setting a name, let's say, will allow us to properly log the latest information from the user. Okay, or in case of an error, we will be able to provide the proper error response to the user. This will be done for all the operations that are interacting with that remote service. So when we are setting the age, we will have the same construct. And more than that, if we would like to set name and age information, then we need to embed that set age call into the set name call, and then we have a cascade of callbacks here, or listeners in our case, where we need to deal based on the responses from the previous call and the current call, and to judge what should be the appropriate response to the user. In this case, if both of the responses are successful, we will log the user details. If not, we will log the appropriate error. And this is not done, let's say, only in isolated code. So usually we will have this code running in an activity or on a fragment. So the code from here will run on, let's say, on create call. So everything that we presented can be embedded in an on create, and here, let's say, more than that, more than logging the user details, we may present the user information like the name in a text view on the user interface. And because of that, because we have an asynchronous call and because we may have delays, it can happen that by the time when we are receiving the response for both of those calls, the activity may be destroyed. And then we need to add some logic to check if the activity is still around, if it's not destroyed. Okay? So we have some code that's already not part of our logic. So the logic, the main logic for us was only to display some user details on the screen, but we already see that we have the success and failure branches that we need to handle. Also, we need to deal with state of the activity. Maybe the activity was destroyed, like we said, by the time when the details were received, or we need to handle also the case on what's happening if we are maintaining the link. So here with that object and the listener call, the user manager listener implementation, we are holding a reference to the text view. So we are holding a reference to the activity. What happens with this listener if we are still maintaining the reference and the operating system decides to recycle our activity or to destroy it? We are creating, unfortunately, using this approach, if we are not paying attention, so if we are not unregistering the listener properly, we are creating a memory leak. Okay. We will have a separate lecture about this and how we can detect and properly fix memory leaks. But today we will discuss how the RX programming will help us preventing such issues. Okay, so theoretically we should focus on our main logic and not think about memory leaks and the state of the activity. As we saw, some of the problems related to the state can be delegated to, let's say, the or solved by using the view model, but we are still dealing and we need to deal with what's happening with those success or failure branches. And we have here quite a few to implement, and we can imagine that we may have multiple steps when dealing with a remote destination. So we may have multiple steps in setting some details for the users even. So we may create a lot of execution threads, and we may lose track on what's happening when. And we, like I said, especially if we are dealing with execution threads, if we need to provide a response to the user, so in this case to run some code on the UI thread, if the rest of the operations are running on the background thread, we may create a lot of such threads that potentially may cause us troubles if we are not properly synchronizing them. So here, as event sources, we can see the cloud or the server as a potential source of events. The database can be seen as an interaction, an async interaction with our application, and also the user can be seen as a source, an asynchronous source, when dealing with the interaction with our app, because we don't know when the user will perform some operations on the UI, and all of them can be seen as asynchronous operations. Even the interaction between the operating system and the application is performed in asynchronous mode, because we are receiving the callbacks whenever the system is scheduling them. Okay, so all the interactions with our app can be seen as async operations. The UI interaction, if we are not, let's say, dealing only with the user, the UI operation is an async operation for us. So the interaction with the user, or the interaction between components, the components of our app. Here we already discussed about some Jetpack components that will allow us to properly deal with the interaction between the UI and the DB using live data, let's say, that will allow us to properly handle the asynchronous calls between the DB and the UI components. The same thing can be done, and we can use live data to retrieve, and we already saw in a sample, to retrieve the information from a remote server using live data. And by the same principle, here we can use also live data to establish a bidirectional connection between our DB and the server. Okay, but what's happening with the operating system? The interaction between the operating system and our application. Also, what's happening with the interaction from the user with the UI of our operating system. So there we are not able to use live data, let's say. So we need a way to be able to model those calls as well. And RX Java or RX Kotlin, and we will see that we have Swift and Dart implementations, are providing us with the methods and the framework that will allow us to model all of them. So all the interactions, all the async operations. So RX was started already a decade ago, and it's quite stable. It's available in Java also, not only on mobile, on desktop and server side as well. And it's a set of classes that will allow us to properly compose and handle our async calls. We will be able to orchestrate all of them in a simple way. And when discussing about asynchronous events, we have sources that are producing. So all those that we presented, let's say before, as DB, server, user, and the Android framework or the operating system, can be seen as three categories of sources: notifications, users' interactions, or messages between applications and servers. We can qualify them as synchronous or asynchronous, and here we can see the difference. So synchronous means that our client or our code will wait for the response, so it's a blocking call, versus the asynchronous, we are performing the call and then we are continuing our work, and sometimes later we will receive the response from the server. More than that, RX is qualifying the capabilities based on the response. So we may get nothing as a response, we may get one item or many items as a response. And also the response can be qualified as a success or a failure response. And some calls may not terminate, so they can be a call that we are subscribed to something and we are watching that subscription indefinitely. Okay, so they will never terminate. At the end of the day, they are behaving like observers, so we are implementing variations of the observer pattern, and because of this they are exposing this to our methods. So we are either getting an observable as a response or a flowable object as a response. And we will see the differences. Now we are seeing here what's common for them. So both of them are capable of emitting none or one or multiple items. And both of them can terminate either as a success or an error state. Okay, the difference between them, so between observable and flowable, is that regarding how they are dealing with the back pressure. And here by back pressure we mean what's happening between the producer and the consumer. Our client will be a consumer for the service. So we can have the analogy here with an inlet, where we can specify based on our need and configure the flow. This is true also for flowables. So we will have methods that will allow the consumer to specify how many items we would like to receive, or how many more we would like to receive. Okay. As an usage, here we can imagine that we have a touchable surface, let's say, a paint view in this case. And we would like to receive the X and Y coordinates, so the motion event, to handle it like an observable. Okay, so each time the user will drag something, we will receive from time to time a location with the current coordinates. Another observable can be created by performing a query in a DB, let's say. So we are selecting something from Firebase, let's say, and we will get an observable object with all the users. And we may change that observable to a flow in this case, because let's say we would like to listen responses from the Firebase engine for all the users, but we are not able to handle more than 3 users at a time, or 300 users at the time. And if we have such constraints, then we are advised to use a flowable, because there we can configure the back pressure. As interfaces, they are looking pretty similar. So we have for the observer interface, we have the next complete on error and on subscribe callbacks. on next will be called each time we are receiving a new item, and on complete will be called only for terminal observables when the stream is done. So we are not receiving anything after that point. So on next will be received per item, and on complete will be received as a notification after the last item. If an error will occur, we will get the callback with the on error with the specify throwable. If we are subscribing to the observer, so if we would like to have a stream that we would like to watch on, then we have the on subscribe callback that allowing us to also destroy the subscription with that disposable object. On the flowable, we have the same methods, so on next, on complete, and on error. And here the subscription has a different argument only. So we have name it, so they name it, the developers, the architects, they name it subscription. And they are behaving exactly the same with the observable, the difference being that on the subscription of the flowable, we can configure the back pressure. That's the only difference. So here, disposable for the observable has only the dispose method, and the subscription, as we can see, has an additional method named request, where we can specify the number of elements that we would like to consume in a request. And the dispose method here, it's named cancel, and it's canceling the subscription. So if we are getting back to our user interface example that we used, here we may convert the response of the get user to be an observable on the user. Okay, so each time we are performing a get user operation, we will get, instead of getting a user, we will get an observable on that user, and we can subscribe on it, or we can properly dispose the listener if it's only one time. Like we said, the sources can be qualified in multiple ways, and another so based on those qualifications, we will have different objects or different observable specific implementations for them, and based on their response we can have a single, like we said, a single implementation. We will get only one response, and that can be either a success or a failure. If it's a success, we will get only one item, and we are not able to control the back pressure for this response. Another type of an observable is the completable one. So here we are still getting two variations, so either a success or a failure, but we don't have an item. So in case of the success, we only get a response that the operation was successfully performed. And similar to single, we don't have back pressure support. And here it's making sense because it's a single response. We will not, so for both of them, we are not able to configure the back pressure. Maybe is another type of a response. Here we have three type of responses. So if it's success, it can be with an element, only one element, or without an element. So we have two types of success responses, or we have a failure. So that's the difference between single, completable, and maybe. Single is also named a scalar observable. Completable is also named runnable. And maybe is also named optional. And you'll see, depending on the author of the tutorials or the books, they may change the names of them to scalar or to completable, or instead of using maybe, they will use optional. Now that we know about those types, we can properly specify the response type for our operation. So here for set name and age, we will use completable because we don't care about the response. We only care about the state of the response, if it's either a success or a failure state. And to create a source, we can create sources for flowables and observable using some operators like just. So flowable just and a string will create us a flowable object that will emit, so will push as a response the hello world. And we have overloaded operations where we can specify a lot of strings for both observable and flowable. We have implementations for maybe and also for single. We can also configure streams of flowables and observables from arrays and from iterable sources. So the idea is that they are providing a lot of operators that are allowing us to basically convert any type of structure into an observable or a flowable source. So once we have them, we are able to properly encapsulate the call, the async call. Even if we have a method that, let's say, we are not able to easily change its signature, we can wrap the whole method in the from callable call, and that will convert that method in an observable. Here we have a sample on how we are using the OKHTTP client with the observable. So here we are using that last from callable call, where we are executing the client and we will get an observable as a response. Here we have another sample using, let's say, the hello string. So we are creating a source and we would like to be able to subscribe on it. So the lambda here as a response type will have the observable on subscribe type. And because we are pushing strings, we can use the generic string implementation. And this is how we are, let's say, emitting our information. So on next, we will push hello. And after that, because we would like to push only one item, we will call on complete. Okay. Another variation, we can use a function, like we said here, and implement the logic in the function with the same observable emitter. Okay, all of those are the ones presented here are synonym calls, so either of them will produce the same behavior. Obviously, we will use the first one presented on the slide here, the top one, because it's more compact. So using the create operator and specifying the type of the output, we will be able to easily create an observable object. And we can chain multiple responses using the onNext calls. Here we can see how we can wrap an UI call to create an observable. So let's say on a click listener, we can wrap it to capture all the events that the text view is producing. So here, text view set on click listener will produce us for each value that the text view is capturing, will produce us an event that will be added in the observable using the onNext call. If we are getting an error, so if we don't have configured properly the listener, or if we are getting an error, we can cancel the stream using the setCancelable call. And here we can see how we can use the same create operator to register the responses from an HTTP client. So on error, we will call the it.onError call, so on failure, and on response we will call the on next. This is assuming that we are getting only one response. Okay, if we have multiple ones, we will call on next each time, and when we are done with all the calls, then we will call on complete. So here, like we presented, we can wrap our sources into either observable or flowables based on the need. And we have, in general, we will have the following structure. So we will observe a source, let's say in this case, a source that is producing string information, and then we will subscribe on that observable. And when we are subscribing, we said that we have those three implementations, that callbacks that will allow us to react on complete the final callback. So after everything was terminated successfully, on next per item, and on error if we are getting an error. After on error, we will not receive an on complete call. So only after on next we may get another on next or an error, or if everything was all the operations were successful, at the end we will get an on complete callback. And you may ask how we are disposing this object. So the subscriptions, like we saw for observable, will return us an disposable object. And here on that object, we will be able to call the dispose method. And usually we will perform that dispose in the on destroy call. Another approach, if let's say we have only one time operation, so we are not subscribed to receive multiple events, we can use observable dot subscribe with, and then provide the disposable object, and that will return us the disposable object that we can dispose afterwards. What's nice about RX is that's available, like we said, on all those platforms. So it's a set of classes that are representing the sources, a set of classing to consume or to listen for the output, and we have another set of methods to compose the data. And they are named, like we mentioned, operators. They are allowing us to combine or to translate or to emit certain different events based on our rules. So here we can see the normal two upper string operation as an operator because it's transforming our string. If we are converting that string to an observable, then as an operator here, we may still use the same two upper, but we will map that element, so each element from our observable to another element. You maybe already recognized this type of operations, the dot map operator, that will be applied per element. And here for each element, we will call the Java two upper case method. And if we are getting back to our sample with setting the user name and the age, and we would like to transform it using RX, we will have something like this. So the get user will be, because we are receiving an observable, we will capture that into an observable of the user type. And after that, we will subscribe on it. And here we can specify when we are subscribing using the observe on operator. We can specify a context where the thread should be executed. And here, by using the Android schedulers dot main thread, we are specifying that the operation should be executed on the main thread. And if we are performing a call to a server to retrieve the user information, by using, let's say, the same OKHTTP library, here we can see how wrapping, as we saw, the call, the execute, using the from callable operator, will get us a response. But as we know, Android framework is denying us executing network calls on the main thread. So we will use the subscribe on with the schedulers.io context. This will ensure that that network call is not executed where the UI is running, so on the main thread. It will be executed on a dedicated input-output background thread. Okay, and here we can see samples on how to consume the other or to transform the input. In general, the operators are dealing with the events, and let's say we have an observable source that is emitting 9 items, let's say, and if we are representing them on the temporal axis, they will be received with those gaps. We have operators like first that will ensure that we are getting only the first element that was emitted, and after that we will get the completed callback. So that black bar after the element is representing the on-complete call. Another way of specifying that we would like to get only the first element is to use get of zero on, like, on a list of longs, and we retrieve only the first element. So that's the analog operation on observables by using first. Okay, so if we don't have anything in the stream, first will not return us anything, so it's a single only, and we will get a failure callback in that case because we don't have anything. If we are using first element, then we are getting a maybe as a response, and as we know, maybe can be empty, and then we get the terminal if the source is still not pushing anything. If we have a lot of elements in the stream, and we are using the ignore elements, we will get only the completable response with the on complete callback. Okay, so all the elements will be ignored. On the flowable, we have almost the same operators, and they are behaving exactly the same. So first will return us the first one. First element is returning a maybe with a complete, and ignore elements will return us a completable with on complete call. You can check all of them, and there are hundreds of operators, and in this web page you'll see a nice UI representation for each of those explained, and you'll see more than that, so not only the UI representation, you'll see code sample for each supported language there. So for Kotlin, Java, JavaScript, C, C Sharp, all the supported languages are presented there. So here, if we are converting our get user call to use Rx, like we said, we can use subscribe with, and we may provide a disposable object, and we will have those three callbacks. And in the on next, because we may have multiple responses on get user if we are listening to, we will push the user information to the UI using the text view.text callback. This is allowed us to be done because we added observe on and we specify the main thread. So the call on the observable here will be executed on the main thread. Like we said, usually we will perform the on create, the logic to create the observable, to register to the source on the on create method, and on destroy we will dispose the subscription. As dependencies, here we have three dependencies because we would like to use the Rx in Kotlin. We have the Rx Kotlin dependency because we are running on Android. We have the Rx Android, and they are advising. So usually only those two are enough, but they are advising us to specify also the Rx Java dependency that is used by the Rx Android dependency to link it to a specific version, the latest version, to benefit from all the bug fixes that are in the latest version. And we have a demo here. The project is named Rx Demo. And if we are deploying it, I think I already deployed it here, but I will deploy it again just to be sure. And what we are doing here is we are performing some calls to learn about different type of sources. So the ones that we saw on the slides with just and a string source is done in the hello world. And here you can see how we can on complete or on next, we can push different information on the screen. So here on next, we are pushing the received item, and on complete, we are appending the hello world completed call. And we can see here on the app how it was performed. We have another method named from operator, and here we are presenting how we are constructing an observable from a list of items, and then we are mapping using the map operating. We are performing the square root of each element that is received. Then we are skipping the first two from the next results, and then we are applying the filter operator to present only the ones that are divisible by two. Okay, so we can see here how we can change operators, and after performing the map, we are skipping and then filtering the result. And here on subscribe, we are presenting the result. Okay, so the first two were skipped, and then we have 16 for the even ones and 36 for that six. The last one is the fetch one, and here we are presenting a demo on how we are connecting to two different sources. So we are connecting to Google and Yahoo, let's say, and we are converting the calls to observables, and then we are chaining them or combining them using the zip operator, and we would like to present to the user a single response when both of the results are received from those two sources. So here we can see an easy way on how we can orchestrate, and we can ensure that only once we receive both of the responses from all the from both of the sources, or we may have multiple sources, only then we should present the response to the user. We are taking a 10 minutes break, and after the break we will continue with our topics with the rest of the demos. Okay, so we are just back. We saw the demo with the RX on Android. Please let me know if you are able to properly hear and see me. And I'm switching to slides now. So we have a lot of options. The first one is to use callbacks, and maybe you heard about this, the ladder approach, or it has a lot of names where we are embedding a lot of callbacks, one in the other, so it's creating a not so easy to maintain code. Another way, and it's usable also on Android, is to use future objects, and this is a response to the callback approach. Here we are capturing the responses in future objects, and we may test if we get a successful or a failure response. Another paradigm is to use promises. And there are frameworks that are available on mobile as well, like React Native or frameworks for Android and also for iOS that is allowing us to use the promise approach, so the callbacks, the listeners in this way. We just saw RX as an option, and another option that the Android framework team with Kotlin is providing for us is the coroutines. Okay, so coroutines are a way on creating lightweight execution threads, something more lightweight than a thread. And is allowing us to suspend the current, let's say, execution thread, the current execution flow, until we will get a response from a particular call. Okay, and there are variations. So here, if we are checking. Yeah, like Rizwan is saying, it's runnable on steroids. If we would like to start with a sample, let's say that we would like to implement a post item call, so the last function that's available on the screen right now, we would like to post an item in a group, let's say. And in order to post something on that specific forum, let's say, we need an authentication token, as we saw with GW framework or with Google services. We need a way to authenticate ourselves. So here we encapsulated that logic in the request token call, and then we are creating the actual post. And sometimes we need parts of the token to be embedded in the call, so that's why here we are providing the token and the item. And once we have the post created, then we are calling the process post call. And here we are ignoring, let's say, in the request token how the actual request is implemented, but we may notice that the actual authentication step may take some time, and we need to stop our execution. So we are not able to create the post and then to process the post until we don't have the actual token retrieved. Okay. Also, the creation of the post may be taking some time because we don't know what is the content of the post. Maybe we need to read an image, or maybe we need to wait for the user to supply some information. So that can take some time as well. The post processing part, that's something that obviously may take some time, and we are not able to control the execution because we are pushing the content to the server. So for us, the request token is a blocking call because all the others may take time, but they may not start even until we receive the token. Okay, so that's a stop blocker for us, if you like. If we are converting them to coroutines, and this is the nice thing about coroutines, and this is why coroutines is preferred to RX, is because of the way on how we can easily implement them. So we can say suspend here for the request token. We are annotating the function with the suspend keyword. That means that that call may it's asynchronous and it may take some time, and the next operations after that suspend function call should wait until the operations are completed. In the same manner, like we said, the create post may take some time and it can be asynchronous, so we can annotate that one with suspend. In Android Studio, you'll see whenever we are performing a call to a suspend function, we will get in the editor, in the it's named gutter section, there where we are seeing the line numbers as well. We are getting an icon that's looking like the ones we presented here on the slides. That will signal us that that call is a suspend call, and the next operations will be delayed until we are receiving the response. If you like, if we are comparing to the JavaScript framework with the promises, here we have an async call and an await on the same line. You'll see that with coroutines we have await calls as well, and we will see the difference. But as an analogy, here we have an asynchronous call, and our post item call will wait for that request to be performed and then continue the operations. We have a rule. We are not able to call a suspend function outside of a suspend context. And here, because we don't have a context, by annotating the post item we suspend will allow us to perform that call. Compared to RX and callbacks and listener approach, here we can easily embed suspend calls in for loops, let's say. So here the create post can be triggered in a for loop if we need to. Also, we can easily wrap the call in a try catch block, and we can perform exception logic related to let's say a bad token exception or something like that. We can also use higher order functions like for each in this case to create tokens from a file. Any of the higher order functions like repeat, filter, map can be used with easily can be used with suspend functions. Okay, because like I said, we need to perform the calls in context that is aware of the suspend functions. We have builders that are allowing us to build context like those, because we will not be able to add the suspend functions on all our calling hierarchy. So at some point, we will need to create the context. And here, like we said, if we are not adding the suspend for the post item method call, we will get errors for those two calls, even signaled in the IDE. So a message like the function request token should be called only from a coroutine or another suspend function. Okay, and like we said, we can use a builder, and in this case we are using the launch builder. It's part of an object named global scope. There are particular scopes that define all sorts of builders. Here we are using the global scope. Global scope means that this scope is available throughout the application, and the launch builder from here will ensure that we are able to perform the suspend calls. Okay? Because in the create post we have some logic that is interacting with the UI. It's advised to use, or it's mandatory to use, the main dispatcher. So here, similarly to RX, where we were specifying the main thread, we have the dispatchers.main, and by performing that call, everything that's wrapping in that launch builder will be executed on the main thread, on the UI thread. Okay. This is the actual implementation of the builder. I removed only the comments from there, but as we can see here, it has a context that we can specify, and by default is the empty context. We can specify how the coroutine should be started, and there are a couple of modes. A lazy one, we are using the default one. Default one means that it will start right in the moment where we are performing the call. And then we have the actual block of code, so a function that will return unit, and it's a suspend function. The launch call, as we can see, it's returning a job object, and that job object can be joined. It's similar to a process object from Java, if you like, where we can track the actual coroutine. We can join it, so we can make the code, the calling code, wait on it. And the actual implementation here, we can see if the start parameter is lazy, then we are creating a lazy coroutine. If not, we are creating a normal coroutine, and after that we are starting that coroutine with the actual function to be called. As dependencies, we have only two: the coroutine's Android's dependency, and also the coroutine core dependency. And we have a demo for this. Open lecture 6 on our GitHub repository. It's named coroutine demo. And here, let's deploy the demo. We need to update the plugins. We will do that after the call. So what we are doing here, we created an app that is highlighting some operators also, and is trying to create the number of either threads or coroutines configured by this slider. And the minimum value is 1000, and let's start 1000 threads. So usually to start, you'll see in our code, we are not doing anything extraordinary here. So when we are starting the threads behind the scenes, here we have a call named create threads, and from a list of delays, and the delays are random here, we are creating one thread, so one thread at a time, that will only sleep the amount of time. And I think the biggest delay is also 1 second here set. You can check the code how we are initializing the delays. And what we are doing in our create threads call, we are starting all the threads, and then we are waiting, we are joining for each of those, and we are adding some messages here. And the create thread calls is wrapped by a capture running times here, and in capture running times you can see that we are capturing the current time, and we are presenting it on the screen here, the start, the end, and what was the different in seconds. So it took 4 seconds to create 1000 threads that only idle. Okay, so we didn't do a lot of operations. The same call from here is used when we are creating the coroutines, and the coroutines are similar here, created similarly. We are wrapping all the calls in a coroutine scope to be able to use our operators on coroutines. We are using the launch builder that we saw on the slides, and we have a delay call here, which is similar to the thread sleep call that we used for threads, but it's not a non-blocking operation. So meaning that while we are performing the delay, other coroutines can use the CPU to perform their jobs. And we can start also the coroutines here, and we can see that it's comparable as times to execute 100 coroutines. We can change a little bit here the slider. Let's create just under 1000 threads. This will take a bit, so a couple of seconds here, and then we will try. So we can see already that it took double the seconds to 8, and if we are starting the coroutines here, we will see that we are almost using the same time as for threads. And you can try it on your machine. We can try with something like 500,000 coroutines. We will not try to start 500,000 threads, because that will kill us as an app. But the coroutines, you'll see that eventually they will finish. So we will finish them in a couple of seconds, under a minute usually. Okay, and you can try to execute it on your machine, and I configured here up to 1 million coroutines. Is taking a lot of time, but eventually we will be able to create all of them. So the call with 500,000 coroutines finished, and it took 22 seconds to perform. We have another logic here named task that we can perform using coroutines named next Fibonacci. And here we can see how we can use the sequence builder. So sequence is allowing us to perform some code. Here we are calculating the next Fibonacci number, and we have a state, so the current and the next, and we have a while loop here. Theoretically, if we are performing a call like this with a while loop, it will try to consume all the CPU. But because we are using the yield suspend function here, we will release the CPU to other coroutines, and we are pushing the current value here. So on each call, we will perform a step and then yield the execution. So we are getting or releasing the CPU to be used by other execution threads, and only when the call will be performed again, we will continue the logic. And here we can see that each time we are pressing next Fibonacci, we are computing a new value. Let's press it multiple times here. I think I don't have the latest implementation of this app, because we added here a scrollable list to be able to see what's behind. I will push in the repo the latest changes here. So I think I opened the project from a wrong location. Anyway, the idea is that using sequence and yield operators, We will be able to perform the call from here only when the user is pushing the button, so when the user is interacting. And to implement something like this without coroutines, with RX, it's doable, but it's not as easy and simple to implement like doing it with coroutines, okay? Please check the sample that we used. So as an usage here in general, we will launch, we will use the launch builder to create a new coroutine in which we will perform long running operations or operations that are asynchronous. We have some helper builders in the view model. So because like we said, when we discuss about view model, it's a state object that will survive application states. There, it's a good place to perform subscriptions to a backend, let's say, to a server. And because it's a frequent pattern that we will use, the Jetpack team provided builders on the view model, and they created a scope, especially for coroutines, named view model scope, where we can launch our computations in a separate coroutine, okay? And it's available if we are performing that dependency as well. So once we have, let's say, the computation available as a coroutine, we can also use the emit operator, and we can combine it with live data if we would like to emit the results using live data. And we, for this, we have another implementation. So live data can be used together with coroutines, and we can create new events using the emit operator. Okay. Now, because there is the need to create flow operation stream to handle stream of data, they implemented an object named flow, which behind the scenes is behaving like a stream of object. Here we can see how we can declare a main function as the using the running blocking builder as capable of running coroutines. And here our foo coroutine that is only performing a delay and returning a list of elements can be consumed like a stream. So if we are running it like this, let's say, without using flows, we will get 1, 2, 3 as an output, because we are using the for each operator, and we are printing each value that is received. Okay, if we are changing it to a flow, we can do more than that. So let's say we are changing our full implementation to delay 100 milliseconds. So we still push 3 values using that emit from 1, 2, 3. In our main function, we change here to start another coroutine using the launch builder, and we are performing similarly 3 steps here, and on 100 milliseconds intervals, we will print "I'm not blocked." Okay, so we will say "I'm not blocked," and then the step number. And after launching this coroutine, we are also starting our flow, and we are collecting the results from the flow. So the collect is an operating that operator that's available on flows that will collect each value. And for each value, we are still printing, like we did before with the coroutines, we are still printing the results. Because we are using a flow and emit, that collect will be able to run in the same time with our launch coroutine. and we will get an output like this. Because of that delay for each element from the flow, the first coroutine will print I'm not blocked. Then we will get, after 100 milliseconds, we will get the item from the flow. Then 100 milliseconds have passed from the launch coroutine, and we are printing I'm not block number two, and so on. So we are able to see that both of those coroutines are running in parallel, and they can provide interleaved output for us. Okay. The flows are cold. That means that they will not be initialized and triggered only in the moment where we are using them. And here in our main function, you can see that we are calling the flow, and then we are collecting it. And in the output, if we are checking, so we are collecting it twice here, we can see that we are calling foo, then we are constructing the flow and nothing happens, so we don't see the flow started call only after the calling collect method was triggered. Then we are seeing flow started. Okay, and once the flow is constructed, each collect will produce the same elements again for us, so the flow will be restarted. We will not see again, let's say, calling collect or something like that. Okay. To cancel a flow, we have some operators like with timeout or null, where we can specify a timeout in milliseconds. And here, let's say we have the same implementation with 100 delayed milliseconds. And theoretically, we should, without the with timeout or null operated, we should see three values presented at 100 milliseconds intervals. But because we added a hard timeout at 250, we will see only the first two. And after that, we will print done. So the third element will not be emitted anymore, because in this context, we canceled already the flow. Okay, so that with timeout or null is canceling our flow after 200 milliseconds. And this is something that we can use when we are connecting to a DB or to a server, and we would like to perform the call and wait up to a certain amount of time. Okay, and if we are not getting everything in that amount of time, we will print only the interim results, or we will cancel the connection. And as you can see, it's pretty easy to wrap our normal call into another operator to cancel the call. And we have a lot of operators, so the usual ones like map and collect are available for flows as well. So here with the same logic to have three elements, you can see that we are using here a builder named as flow to convert a list of integers into a flow. And then we are performing the dot map call, the dot map operator, and we are calling a function for each element. We are delaying for 1 second here, and we are returning, we are transforming the return by appending the response name. And at the end, we are collecting everything and printing on the screen. So instead of printing 1, 2, 3, now we are printing response 1, response 2, and so on. Okay. Another operator is the transform operator, which, like the name suggests, is allowing us to transform the output from one object to another. In this case, we are emitting different elements. So we are starting from integers, a list of integers in the flow. And as you can see, we can use the emit call to create new elements in our flow for each source. And we are able to see that using collect, we will receive all of them. So it will say making request one. And after that, we will see the response because we have a delay of 1 second there. We have the first response. Okay. On after finishing the transformation, we will collect the next element and we will apply the transformation and so on. Okay. We can limit the number of elements. So here you can see that our source is emitting 3 elements, and by using take 2 operator from here, when we are collecting, we are collecting only the first 2. Okay, so we will not see even that print statement that is saying that that line will not be executed. Okay. Also here we can see how we can use the map reduce approach that Google is using all over the place. So using the map operator, we can square the numbers, and then by using reduce, we can sum all of them, and using a flow, we will be able to sum all the square numbers, the value of the square numbers from 1 to 5. Okay, we have a demo here as well. So in our Git repository, the application is named Flow Demo, and if we are running it. Hopefully it will start. It seems that our Android Studio is taking a break, so maybe we should restart it. Force quit. We will restart it. Okay, open flow demo, this window. Okay, so it did work this time. And here we have a simple application that is using flows. So we are creating a flow as a result from this function that will emit either tick or tack, and it will behave like seconds on a clock. And you can see how easily we created in a loop. We are emitting either of the two, and then we are sleeping, we are delaying for 1 second. And in our on create, we are launching using the default coroutine scope. We are launching and we are collecting, we are launching a coroutine, and then we are collecting the flow using the collect operator, and we are updating the current text on the UI. Okay, so this is something simple just to highlight how we can collect flows. You can see more details about flows and other operators that are available to coroutines and flows by following the link that we provided below. Here are the outcomes, but we have also to demo Rx on Swift today. And here in the same GitHub repository, you'll see that we have an Rx Swift demo application where let's run, or I think it's already running in the simulator. Here we created a calculator app And we have also a login, and we have some validations on login. So it's saying here that the username and the password should have at least 3 characters, and if we are providing 3 for the username and only 2 for the password, we can see that it's saying it's invalid. And once we have 3 for the password, we are passing the validation and it's saying that's valid. We can log in and we are getting our calculator here, and we can provide two numbers here. And by default, we are doing an addition, and we can change easily the operation here. And everything is done using Rx. So we have here, maybe we should start from the controller. So this is the login page where we are using Rx to bind our username field from the UI to our model username field. And we are doing the same for the password. And you can see here how we are using subscribe to the is valid call. So if we are checking the login view model, you can see here that is valid is an observable that is combining two other observables. So by using the combine latest operator, we are combining the two and we are performing the validation here. We are checking if the email and the password are having at least 3 characters. Okay. And in the controller, you can see here on the subscribe, we will get a response. And if the response is valid, then we are presenting valid or invalid as a text message, as we saw. And then if we are performing the login, we are moving to the next view controller here that has those two fields from here, the numbers. We have the operator, and then we have the buttons from here to add, subtract, multiply, and divide. And all of them are handled as events using Rx. So we are binding, like we did for login, we are binding the text fields to the view model, the first and the second numbers. Then we are binding the operation when we are changing the operator here also to an observable. And the answer is also using Rx to map the response to our text here as a result. Each time we are pressing on the button, we are actually subscribing to a change operator event. So if we are checking the calculator view model here, we can see that we have two observables, one for computing the answer based on the operation, and another one for establishing the operation when we are changing the button from here. And the change operation will trigger the change operation stream from here. Okay, so you can check this project to see how we configured and use Rx in Swift. Okay, and we have another sample named Rx Flutter. For Flutter here, and let's start the application here as well. I think it's running on the emulator by default. So here, here we are using Rx Dart. There is an Rx Flutter package that I just noticed today that they created it, but we are using Rx Dart here. And we are having an app that is connecting to a public server that is able to return us images based on a keyword. So here, if we are supplying view, let's say, we will get a response with some images containing that are annotated for the view. Let's say mobile. So we have images that are containing a mobile phone, and it's a list. You can play with it. We are using also again the block pattern here. So if you will check, like we did last time when we discussed about the block, we have a stream and the sync implementation. And here what we are doing, we are using in the repository each time we are getting a call to query for a response from the server. If we are checking the repository, here is the provider, the image provider, that is connecting to the service, and you can check how we establish the connection. We need to supply a key, and I will not show the key right now here, because each developer should register and it will receive its own key. Here we are presenting how we are composing the query. So we have an API, and then we are adding our keyword and the API, and based on that we will get a response. And from the URL here, you can see how we are retrieving an actual image. This is the implementation of our repository. Okay, so here we have some providers where we will get we will encapsulate the call to hide the asynchronous call. And in the home screen, so in the main application here, we are only setting up the scaffold, and then we have the home screen. And in the home screen here, we are building the UI, that search combo box here with this text field. And after that we have a block, so a stream builder with our block that is consuming the photos from here. And in the block photo list here, you can see how we are using Rx, and here mainly the operators. We are adding a debounce here. Debounce means that we should not like to perform the call on each character, so we should wait at least 300 milliseconds to collect all the characters in that 300 milliseconds, and after that to perform the call. And we are using the where operator as well here to check if the stream field had some value. And after that we are transforming the stream as we see here. So after performing the call from the repository, we are querying for each character a response, and we are emitting the value. So we are adding it into the sync to be available to be consumed by the observables from the UI, or we are pushing an error, and we are logging also the error on the screen, and we are pushing it as an error in the stream. And in our home builder here, if we will have data, we will create the list. If not, we will present the error on the screen. Okay, and this is the logic to compute to display an image per item in the list. So please check this sample as well to see how we are connecting to a service, to a remote service, and how we are consuming using Rx Dart in this case the responses and the interaction from the user. This is all for today. So if you have any questions, please let me know in the chat, and I will try to answer them. Any feedback or any questions, please do let me know. I will wait a couple of seconds, because I know that the stream is having a 10 seconds delay at least. So please do let me know. Anyone? No questions? No feedback? Is anyone still available on the stream or not? Yeah, we will, Horatio. I will re-upload the first part and I will add the missing slides. Thank you. So Florine is asking, in Flutter, how we can send a service or a repository to another activity. So here, I'm assuming that you are asking how we can send an object to another activity, a service or a repository as an object. So usually you should recreate the service and the repository in the other activity, but you can send it also. So if you will check the navigation package there, you'll see that the navigate to has a destination, and also you can supply arguments, and those arguments can be also objects like services or repositories. Okay, I hope that's answering your question. Razvan is mentioning about the slides. Yeah, so I will add them. I will publish the video with the first part updated. Anything else? You're welcome, Florian. If you don't have anything else, I wish you a good day. And please take care, stay safe, and we will see us in the next laboratories. Okay? Take care. Have a nice day. Bye.